In this chapter, we discuss the various factors that go into setting price of high-tech products and services. Pricing has both strategic and tactical dimensions. In this chapter, we will focus mainly on the strategic aspects of pricing while also recognizing the importance of the tactical aspects of pricing, including various types of promotions such as discounts, rebates, and coupons, among others. Strategic pricing involves setting list or published prices that stay in place over the long term. The strategic importance of pricing can be understood from the fact that of the four P's of the marketing mix, price is the only P that brings in revenue to the organization. All the other P's, product, promotion, place, are cost generators. Price and revenue help the company meet all its expenses, so it should be decided only at higher levels within an organization and should not be changed frequently. Yet it is the easiest of the four P's to change because it entails just changing list or published prices. Hence the need to strike a balance between all the factors that could affect price. The idea of balanced pricing is illustrated by the metaphor of this stool in the diagram. Stability of the stool depends on careful consideration of the three C's. Costs set the floor on price. We should not set long-term price below cost because that will likely lead to the demise of the business. Customers' willingness to pay a certain price sets the ceiling. Pricing above this level will lead to lack of demand and eventually business demise. Between the floor of costs and the ceiling of customers' willingness to pay, price levels are set based on positioning objectives relative to the competition. If your product has a premium positioning, price above the competition. If it is a Me Too product, price to match the competition. And if you are an unknown brand trying to catch up in the marketplace, price below competition. One of the ways in which a business could have a cost and price advantage over the competition is by exploiting the experience curve. The concept of the experience curve is that businesses can lower product unit costs by efficiencies gained from higher volume, as well as employees learning to do things better and faster over time. These cost savings can lead to a sustainable, low-priced advantage. Companies like Amazon, Dell, Ryanair, and Sony are able to exploit the experience curve to have a low price strategy over time. Here are pictures of the experience curve. The two diagrams present essentially the same data with one difference. The axes in the right diagram are logarithmic transformations of the basic data in the left diagram, so the experience curves on the right appear linear. The top black line is a 90% experience curve. The middle red line is an 80% experience curve. And the bottom dotted black line is a 70% experience curve. The steeper the experience curve, the greater the experience effect. We expect high-tech products to have steeper experience curves than low-tech products because there is not as much scope to learn how to do things better for a low-tech product. If a high-tech product starts out with a unit cost of $100 for the first unit, then the unit cost for a 70% experience curve becomes $70 when the cumulative production reaches 2 units. When the cumulative production reaches 4 units, the new unit cost is going to be 70% of $70, which is $49, and so on. The Tesla Roadster was launched in 2008 with a base price of about $100,000. In 2012, when Tesla launched the Model S, the base price came down to $70,000. And then in 2017, when Tesla launches its Model 3, the base price is going to come down to $35,000. Tesla's aggressive pricing of its electric cars in recent years is enabled in large part by experience curve effects. Competitors' prices are a good benchmark for how a business should set prices according to its positioning objectives. Samsung wants to be seen as a worthy rival of Apple, so its devices are priced on par with Apple products. On the other hand, Dell's products are priced substantially below Apple and Samsung because it wants to be positioned as a low-cost competitor. Even radical or breakthrough innovations have to be priced carefully to incentivize consumer adoption. Radical innovations have to compete against the inertia or indifference of consumers. The Segway was launched in 2001 at a price of $8,000 and received lukewarm market response. There may be other products which satisfy the same consumer need. These product substitutes should also be considered competitors. Regular gas cars need to take note of the emerging competition from electric vehicles as a product competitor. Cross-price elasticity of demand is always positive. As the world price of gas has declined over the past few years, the demand for electric vehicles has also slowed down, because they are not seen as offering as much cost savings over gas cars. Generally, an increase in the number of competitors reduces prices. However, in case of information products of unknown quality, such as consultants' reports or market forecasts, users are willing to pay more because the information from different sources is complementary to each other. That's why market forecast studies from firms like Forrester and Gartner cost thousands of dollars. The maximum price a customer is willing to pay for a product depends on their perception of the value of the product. Customers' assessment of value depends on their analysis of the benefits of the product in relation to the costs. Customers generally consider four types of benefits. First, functional benefits are the utilitarian aspects of the product. For example, does the product make things easier or better for the user? Does it help the user to be more effective or creative or accomplish certain tasks? Second, operational benefits are improved efficiency, reliability, or durability. Third, financial benefits make it easier for the user to pay for the product. Finally, personal or psychological benefits include ego satisfaction, status, prestige, and the like. Costs have monetary components such as acquisition price, transportation, installation, and training, as well as non-monetary opportunity costs such as product failure, obsolescence, switching costs, and learning costs. If you buy a piece of equipment from an unknown supplier and it breaks down during use, your productivity is going to take a hit, which could result in lost revenue. While not a direct expense, this is an opportunity cost because of the lost opportunity to make revenue when the equipment is down. Reference price is the benchmark price that a customer uses to evaluate the price of a product under consideration. It could be based on past experience. However, for high-tech durable products with long inter-purchase cycles, past prices may be less relevant than current competitors' prices. Customers may also form reference prices from the current environment in the absence of prior experience or data on competitor prices. If someone is buying a product for the first time without any research on competitor prices, they may form reference prices based on cues in the shopping environment. That's why a retail store sale with signs saying price was $99, now $79, may have the $99 old price be the reference price for an uninformed consumer. Total cost of ownership is the cost of acquiring, maintaining, and disposing of a product over its entire life cycle. The total cost of ownership of a car, for example, includes the price of bringing it home, fuel costs, maintenance costs, insurance, depreciation, less the resale value of the car if it is resold. The principle of segmentation suggests that a business may charge different prices to different segments based on how critical their products or services are to the users in each segment. Dell supplying laptops to a factory for online process control of manufacturing processes can probably charge higher prices than supplying the same laptops to a public school district for educating students. In general, businesses can charge users more for products that deliver more benefits. A hospital can levy higher charges for taking care of a critically ill patient than an outpatient clinic can charge for a flu shot. Pricing decisions should be made early during new product development for greater market success at launch. Trade-offs between features and functionality during new product development affect price and vice versa. The principle of target costing starts with recognizing the maximum price the market is willing to pay for the product. Unit profit objective is deducted from the market price to arrive at a target cost. Let's say the given market price for a new four-door sedan is $20,000. If the unit profit objective is $5,000 per car, then the target cost for this product is $20,000 minus $5,000, which is $15,000. Then R&D has to choose materials, work with marketing on trade-offs for features and functionality, and deliver a new car at this level of target cost of $15,000. More and more, we are seeing businesses track the profitability of individual customers thanks to the availability of marketing automation and lead tracking software such as Eloqua, Marketo, Pardot, and Salesforce, among others. It is fine for a company to give notice of termination to its unprofitable customers. This needs to be done with a lot of forethought and in a kind and gentle manner so that the company does not attract negative publicity or is not viewed as greedy or unfair by the general public. Most high technology products, especially new platforms, require huge investments in research and development, which need to provide a good return. Here are the factors that affect pricing in a high-tech environment. In a high-tech environment, there is a need to recover huge investments in R&D, and this puts up an upward pressure on pricing because of rapid pace of change, short product life cycles, and high unit one costs. On the other hand, there is a downward pressure on price due to Moore's law and network externalities. Moore's law, as originally formulated by Gordon Moore, co-founder of Intel, was that the performance to price ratio of microprocessor chips doubles every 18 months. Another formulation of this is that at the same level of performance, therefore, price gets halved every 18 months. Network externalities is the property that the value of a network increases exponentially with the number of users. In order to attract a large user base, the price of joining the network needs to be reduced. Thus, both Moore's law and network externalities create downward pressure on prices. Here are some other considerations that affect price in a high-tech environment. If customer assessments of cost-benefit are not favorable, they tend to postpone purchase. In that case, price needs to be reduced to allay consumer anxiety and get them to upgrade to the latest product. Competition and the availability of price comparison information on the web tend to lower prices. If a new product is not backward compatible with the investments already made by customers, they will postpone purchase, so prices need to be reduced. Finally, derivatives enable price discrimination by targeting different segments at both the high end and the low end of performance. In most traditional industries, continuously falling prices spell disaster. For example, falling prices in the oil industry, declining interest rates for banks, falling housing prices in the real estate market. Such trends cause panic and confusion in their respective markets. However, this is not so in high tech, where falling prices are very much the norm. The technology paradox is, how can high tech businesses survive and thrive when prices of products are falling? What are the ways in which a high tech business can cope with the technology paradox? First, if a business can reduce costs at a faster rate than falling prices, it will be all right. This is what companies from Amazon to Sony to Tesla do with the help of experience curves. Second, companies like Apple, Google, and Samsung avoid the commodity trap by differentiation and innovation. The principle of mass customization enables customization without simultaneously increasing costs. Dell does this with its build-to-order model, where it allows customers to choose whatever device configurations they want, then Dell takes 48 hours to assemble and ship the product. Dell is able to do so by maintaining inventory of modules and intermediate components rather than finished goods. Third, the business needs to look for new revenue streams in a variety of ways. New uses for existing products become possible when users use their smartphones or tablets for new applications like monitoring and tracking fitness, watching movies, or doing e-commerce transactions. Amazon Warehouse Services offers business customers complete end-to-end cloud-based storage and computing power. Amazon's Prime membership service bundles free shipping and handling along with online orders for a flat annual membership fee. Businesses can choose to target less price-sensitive customers. Apple, firmly entrenched in consumer markets, is making a big push into business markets like healthcare with its iPad Pro tablets. It has enlisted IBM as a partner to develop these business markets. Finally, businesses like automobiles and software use derivatives as a way to target different segments with different prices, which is called price lining. When a business develops and maintains good relationships with its customers, it has a cushion against falling prices because business customers are often willing to pay higher prices for a better relationship. Products like razors and blades, printers and toner ink, video game consoles and game software all practice captive product pricing where the box is given away at a low price. Once the customer adopts the box, then the business can sell them the blades, ink and software at a higher price. When companies give away content or software or entertainment for free, They need to have an advertising-based revenue model to cover their costs, like Facebook and Google. The technology paradox can also be addressed with the use or practice of dynamic pricing, which is the ability of a business to vary price over time by taking advantage of supply-demand conditions. Web auctions on eBay are an example of dynamic pricing that can help sellers get a higher price. Advertising rates on the Super Bowl TV network go up as the date approaches due to diminishing ad inventory. Finally, new product development costs and unit product costs can be significantly reduced by quickly bringing products to market. There are some specific pricing practices prevalent in the high-tech industry that we examine next. These two options address the issue of pricing technology or know-how. An outright sale is a fixed one-time fee that a business may charge for its know-how. It is preferred when the net present value of the technology can be estimated for the life of that technology. However, this is rarely easy to do. So as a practical matter, many high-tech businesses prefer licensing out the technology where the customer is charged an annual licensing fee for a fixed number of years. Multiple user licenses offer discounts for larger number of users and is of greater value to business customers. Pay-per-use increases trial and adoption of a new service. However, subscription pricing is preferred by heavy users as it reduces uncertainty in their projected expenses and cash flow. This concludes our discussion of pricing in a high-tech environment. Thank you.